Hello, everybody, and welcome to the BBC Learning English Live Friday quiz. My name is Dylan, and I'm your host for today. Now, this week, we're looking at what I think is a particularly interesting topic, and one that I'm sure is relevant for many of you. It is university life and academic English. Now, are you studying at university? Have you ever studied at the uni? Would you like to study at university one day? Introduce yourself, tell me your name, and share your stories in the comments. Now, even if you don't plan to ever study English at university, this quiz has something for you. Academic English shares many traits with formal English. So if you'd like to learn to speak more formally, more clearly, more accurately, or more appropriately for business, there's plenty here for you. So stay tuned. Let's say hello. All right, then. Who have you got here today? We got Dat, hello from Vietnam. Hi, good evening to you. We've got a lot of people from Vietnam today. So hi Min, hi Vu. We got Fong. We got Hugo from Mexico. Hi, how are you? And whoops. And Nevia says you studied economics at the University of Granada in Spain. Thanks for sharing. Okay, and we've got hi from Japan and hi from Taiwan, so an international crowd. As always, I love to see it. So let's just go through some of the guidelines for the quiz, if it is your first time here. So there are 8 questions in total. We do the questions first, and we look at the answers later on. Now, the quiz is just for fun. It's a Friday. Happy Friday, everybody. We're here to learn, to relax, to have a good time. It's for fun. Let's have a nice environment. There are no prizes. The only prize is pride in yourself. Okay. And number 3, please like, comment, and share. If you are having a good time, hit that like button. Comment, because that means the more you're engaged, the more likely you are to remember in the long term. And, of course, share with your friends, family members, etc. Okay. Let's have a quick look back in the comments before starting. So who have we got? Loads of comments coming in. Yilin saying, I hope today's questions are not too hard. Well, stick around to find out. We've got Nurana, who is a student at Azerbaijan University of Languages, and you're in your final year. Hi, good luck in your final year. Okay, then. So from Somalia, I can't read your name, apologies. But you're looking for how to improve your writing skills. Well, we've got some top tips today, and we've got a special mystery guest who's going to help you with that later on. And hi from Buenos Aires, hi from Uzbekistan, hello from India, hi to you all. Are you ready to begin? I'll take that as a yes. So let's look at round 1. Okay, and our first questions are going to look at more the wider university life. And then later on, we're going to look at more specifically at academic English and academic language skills. So, question number 1. The large building with many bedrooms where students live is called A, a fraternity, B, the dormitory, C, the sleeper, or D, the residence. So this can be a large room with many beds, or can be a building with many bedrooms where students live. Now, do we call it a dormitory, a fraternity, a residence, or a sleeper? A, B, C, D, what do you think? So we're starting off with a nice, simple vocabulary question to warm us up, and then we'll look more at what I think are the trickier questions of academic writing a little bit later on. I can see loads and loads of you going for B, 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 but there are also a few A's coming in. What do you think? A, B, C, or D? Get your answers in. I'll give you 5 more seconds with this question before we move on. And I can see B is definitely the most popular choice. Okay. Let's move on. Round 2, question number 2. So, What do we call a first-year undergraduate? So this is somebody who is in their first year of university. Do we call them a newbie, B, a novice, or C, a fresher? So this is somebody who has just started university. It's their first terms. They've just begun. Do we call them a newbie, B, a novice, or C, a fresher? What do you think? All right, so we got a bit of variety. We got A. We got an A here, A, but lots and lots of C's, fresher as well. Who do you agree with? Not many B's. So A or C, who are you agreeing with? If Jenny's going for C, Neha's going for C. Who else have we got? C is going for A. And we've got Kanwal going for C. So few more seconds. Get your answers in. Last chance. 3, 2, 1. On we go. Round 3. Okay, now we're going to start a little bit more looking at the specific language of university. Of academic language. Now, which sentence is more appropriate for an academic text? A, you might find it tricky to spot the answer. Or B, it may be difficult to identify the solution. Now, which of these is most appropriate for an academic text? And can you tell me why? That's the big question, the important question. Why is it more appropriate? So let's take a look, see what you are thinking. Okay, kind of split. We got Sarah going for A, while Zaka's going for B. Lego Films is going for B. And Nagoyan is also going for B. So let's have a look. Evgeny's going for, it's more formal. How do we know it's more formal? In what way is it more formal? Okay, let's take a look. Who have you got? Lots of B's coming in. But why? That's the question I'm looking for here. Why? B is professional. Okay, we've got lots of B's coming in. In what way is it professional? How have they made it professional? Okay, that's your question. We'll remember the questions first. We'll look at the answers later on. And that's when I'll tell you what the answer is and why. And how you can make your writing more like the most appropriate choice here. Whew. On we go, flying through the quiz. Round 4. Okay. So here, we're looking for which of these is most appropriate for academic English. Okay, which one is most appropriate? So there could be more than one that fits here. But what's best for an academic essay or an academic presentation, remember, we want to be accurate and clear. Okay, so which of these? Smoking, A, causes cancer. B, smoking can cause cancer. Or C, smoking will cause cancer. What do you think? Which of these is the most appropriate? Okay, so we've got Nia going for A, Bill going for A, Evgeny going for A. Yua has gone for 2 choices, which I think is against the rules, but which one in particular is most formal? Okay. Nin going for B, Tran B, Yoshiaki going for B, can cause. And again, I want you to think about why. So today, every week I ask what is the answer, but today I'm looking for why as well. All right, lots and lots of words. A and B, definitely the most popular choice. C. Louise says B because it's not 100% guaranteed. Interesting thought. Do you agree with C. Louise? And let's have a look. And Jahan says B, 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 B. In science, nothing is sure if you don't get proof. Okay, what do you think? Few more seconds. 3, 2, 1, get your answers in. And we're moving on to round 5, which as every week I say is my favorite round. And that's because we have our special mystery guest. And this week we've got a very special mystery guest who's an expert in academic English. So please welcome to the show, Jan Gibbons. Hi, Jan.
Hi, Dylan. Hi, everybody.
How are you?
I'm fine, thank you.
Good. So first of all, would you like to tell the audience a little bit about yourself, about your background?
Yes, so I work at a university and I work in Liverpool. And for most of the year, I am an academic advisor. So that means that if a student from any faculty has a concern or a problem about how to structure their essay or write their essay, they come to me or someone in my team and we help give them guidance. And then in the summer months, I am a tutor for pre-sessional courses. And a pre-sessional course is one where international students study advanced English in order that at the end of their course, they can progress onto a university course of their choice in the United Kingdom.
Excellent. So it's the start of the year and many students will have just returned or are just returning to university. What are your top tips for those returning students?
Well, I think that you've got to stay motivated. And I think because students have felt a bit isolated recently because of COVID, you mightn't be doing face-to-face classes as much. I think one way to stay motivated is to think about what your end goal is. So why did you do the course? What are you hoping to do at the end of the course? And that should give you some motivation. And my second big tip would be do not be too proud to ask for help. So if you are struggling, remember that in any university situation anywhere, there will always be people on hand to help you with your academic English. It's something everybody has to learn. And so it's a good idea to get support.
Yeah, excellent tips. Now, I think some of the audience will be wondering, what is the difference between academic English and your standard everyday English?
Well, I think one thing is register. So we've had some of your viewers that mentioned this already. So register is the way that we address somebody. And so in academic English, we're part of an academic community, and therefore we are meant to be talking in a more expert way, in a more professional way. And because of that, it means that we should be using language that is more objective. That means without our personal views involved and more formal.
Okay, excellent. And on that note, I believe you've got an academic English question for us.
I have, Dylan. Okay, everybody, here is my question. The BBC was set up 100 years ago. But in academic English, we often avoid using phrasal verbs. So which of these sentences would be best instead? So is it A, the BBC was created 100 years ago? Or B, the BBC was implemented 100 years ago? Or C, the BBC was established 100 years ago?
Okay, nice question. Quite a long question. Could you repeat it again, please?
Yes. If I had to find a more formal way of saying set up, which one of these would be better? Is it A, the BBC was created 100 years ago? Or B, the BBC was implemented 100 years ago? Or C, the BBC was established 100 years ago?
Okay, lovely question. And Jan, I'm sure the audience would be pleased to know that you've agreed to come back to give the answer later on.
I have. I'll give the answer later on.
Excellent. Okay, thanks for joining us.
No
See you
worries.
Soon. Okay, get your answers in and Jan will be back to explain the answer and give the answer later on. What do you think? So we've got lots of C's coming in, but what do you think? So we had created, implemented, or C was established. What do you think? So Alexander's going for created. We've got Linda going for C. Stabilized wasn't one of the choices. So the choices again were created, implemented, or established. Okay, and lots of C's coming in. I think it's the most popular choice, but A's, few B's as well. Okay, let's move on to question number six, round six. Oh, oops, that's not round six. Okay. So here, question number six. It was, achievement. Which would be best in an academic essay? It was a huge achievement. It was a big deal achievement. It was a considerable achievement, or it was a fantastic achievement. So we're looking for the best in academic, formal, written English, so in an essay, which of these would be the best choice? Okay, and we got A. We've got, let's have a look. A again, a huge, very popular answer. And C, okay, considerable also seems quite popular. So we've got A, C. Margarita is going for C. Sally is going for huge. What do you think? Get your answers coming in. And while you do, if you have just joined us, this is the BBC Learning English Live Friday quiz. Okay, we do the questions first and we look at the answers later on. Okay. D or A, says C. Louise, it's more grammatically pleasing. Okay, but which is the best for an academic essay? Two more. Tatiana's going for C and Chit is going for A. So A and C, the most popular choices here. Round seven, let's move on. Round seven. Aha, okay. So, well, here is an open question, no multiple choice here. So, what is wrong with this sentence if written for an academic essay? The results won't be released until they've been verified. Okay, so the results won't be released until they've been verified. So, what is wrong, or how could we improve this sentence here? What am I looking for? So, an open question, I'm looking for your answers rather than a multiple choice like usual. So, a little bit trickier here. Okay, so let's have a look. Sam Chung says contractions. What are contractions and what do you mean by that? I think you're onto something. Okay, well, what exactly do you mean? Let's have a look. Won't, Fabio. Okay, so I think you're onto something as well. But what exactly is the problem with this? Okay, so have been. They have. Is that the issue? We'll find out soon. It is better. Will not would be better, says Fabio. And UU is going for will not be, and they have. Okay, so lots of you saying contractions, but what are contractions and why would it be wrong here? You'll have to wait to find out. Okay, on we go to the last question. Round eight. And round eight is which of these would be best to end a formal presentation? So, A, I'd like to sum up now. B, in conclusion. C, that's all, folks. Or D, one last thing. Now, obviously, in a formal in a presentation, you've got multiple choices, and you could technically use any of these. But which one would be best? What's the best choice for this one here? I'd like to sum up now. In conclusion, that's all, folks. Or D, one last thing. So, which of these do you think is best? Let's take a look. Lots of B's coming in, a few C's, a few D's. Okay, if Jenny going for, I'd like to sum up now. Ashraf going for in conclusion. So a little bit of variety, but I think A and B seem the most popular choices. Oof, 3 seconds to get your answers in. Three, two, one. Okay, that marks the halfway point of the quiz. If you are having a good time, please hit that like button. This is the BBC Learning English Live Friday quiz. If you enjoy our live lessons, you can find us on every other Monday for Vocabulary Live on Facebook and YouTube. Tuesday and Thursdays, Pronunciation Live, YouTube and Facebook. And then on Wednesdays, we have a live class All of these go out at 1:30 p.m. UK time. So if you enjoy a live lesson, please join us. And of course, don't forget, the most important one is the Friday quiz. So let's take a look at the answers, shall we? Let's move on. So, round one. So in round one, we were looking at a relatively simple vocabulary question about university life. And we're looking for the correct choice of word to describe the place where students live and sleep. So this can be the large room where many students live together, or it can be the building where there are many individual rooms where students sleep. And I think many of you got this one correct. Okay, and we've got B's and C's coming in, but the correct answer is the dormitory. Okay, so like I said, a dormitory is a room, building, or part of a building with sleeping accommodation for a number of people. Usually, we use it with students. So this could be one large bedroom, which students share with many beds in it, or it could be used to describe the building where there are lots of individual bedrooms where students live. Dormitory, the word is often shortened to dorm. So I live in a dorm on the south side of town, for example. And a common alternative for the building which many students live in is halls of residence. So I've seen in some dictionaries, they'll say that dormitory is American English and halls of residence is British. But I think we actually use both, and I hear both equally commonly in the UK. Now, have you ever lived in a dorm? How was your experience? For me, I moved to a dormitory when I was 18, and it was my first time living away from home, and I had a fantastic experience. It was great. How was your experience? Now, there are three other choices here. I see some questions coming in. I'll try and address the questions later on. The other words, fraternity is the name for a social group for male students who often live together in the same accommodation. And you've probably heard or seen this idea in lots of Hollywood American films. And typically they show groups of young men live together, have a large house, drink too much, and have lots of parties. So that's a fraternity or a frat house. The female version is a sorority, but they're not really a thing in the UK. We don't really use the word, and we don't have that idea in the UK. A sleeper is the sleeping compartment on a train. Now, we don't have many sleeper trains in the UK because we're too small. We're not that big. But the sleeper compartment or the sleeper train is the part of the compartment is the part of the train where you sleep. And the sleeper train is a train that has sleeping accommodation. And as a resident, is used in halls of residence, or can be used to describe a person's home. It's quite a formal word. So any questions? Okay. So I lived twice in dormitory in my home of Iraq and in Turkey, and you had a good time. Thanks for sharing. Jahan has no personal experience, but you've had friends or partners who've lived there. And it's definitely got advantages and disadvantages. I agree with that, certainly. And Amjan has never lived in a dorm because they went to college from their own house. Okay. So that is, what is a fraternity? A fraternity is a societal group where male students get to do activities together, and they bond with each other as part of one social group. It's also used to describe the building, usually, where they live. Okay, any other questions? Okay. So is the dormitory located on campus? It depends on the university. Sometimes it can be, and sometimes it's not. Okay, question number two. Let's move on. Aha. So a first year undergraduate, okay, somebody in the first year of university is called what? Are they called a newbie? Are they called a novice? Or C, are they called a fresher? So this is somebody who's just joined university for the first time. They're in their first year. What do we call them? A newbie, a novice, or C, a fresher? Get your answers coming in, because we're going to look at the answer very, very soon. 3, 2, 1. Yes, the correct answer is a fresher. So a fresher is a student in their first year of college or first year of university. And it's an informal term, mainly used in British English. Often the first week of university will be called Freshers Week. And there are lots of parties and events to welcome the students to this new walk of life, the new experience of university. They join and there's a Freshers Week to welcome you. In American English, they're similar but slightly different term. They call freshers freshmen or a freshman. Now, obviously, this is quite skewed towards the male perspective. So in recent years, they've started calling them froshers or freshies. So UK, we say a fresher. In American English, they call them freshmen, froshers or freshies. Okay, any questions? Okay, what's the difference between fresher and freshman? Fresher is British English. Freshman is American American English. Shalija asks, because they are fresh. The experience is fresh. They are new to it. Yeah. And Sam says, when I was a fresher, I was already 3 years older than my students. So yes, regardless of age, it's about when you are having your first year's experience of university. Okay, good. And Gamaka has set me up by asking, what is a newbie and a novice? I have got the answers for you. So a newbie is anybody who is new to a situation. It's an informal word, and it's used to describe an inexperienced newcomer. Sometimes... In the last 20 years, there's a new version of this called noob, N-O-O-B. And that's like a modern internet word used to describe a newbie. And then a novice is a person who is new to or inexperienced in a job or situation, particularly when they're just learning how to do something new. Okay, I hope that helps. Let's have a look. Okay. So undergraduate means just the first year. No, undergraduate is the first time you go to university. So when you're doing your bachelor's degree, your first degree is called the undergraduate. And when you do your second degree, so like a master's or PhD, we call that postgraduate. And yes, in the UK, we use fresher for males and females. Yeah. But okay, and we got a nice example sentence from Sam Chung, who says, a fresher walks into the classroom to face the teacher who is a newbie. I love that example. Thank you very much, Sam. Whew, on we go. Which sentence is more appropriate for an academic text? Now, lots of you had the correct answer for this one, but why? Why? And there's a few different areas here we can look at. Which one is the most appropriate and why? Let's take a look. So we got B from Simran Nagoyan's going for A. Angel or Angel is going for B. Alwyn for B. Remo, B. So lots and lots of B's coming in. I noticed it's the first time, and I'm just saying because it is formal and has a clear meaning. Okay, I like the answer. How is it formal? How has the author made that more formal than choice A? So Omnia is saying tricky is a bit more informal. So we're starting to get there, I think. Let's have a look. Any more? Okay, no more comments. So we're going to jump on to the next slide, which is the answer. Yes, it is B. It may be difficult to identify the solution. And there are a few reasons why this is the correct choice. So in academic English, we try to avoid the personal pronoun you. We want academic English to be neutral, objective, cold, hard facts. We don't want to get emotions riled up like in the newspapers. Clear, objective information. So we don't use words like I, me, my, you, your, we. We try to avoid it. Now, this is not an absolute rule, but where possible, we try to make other linguistic choices. And then, as many of you pointed out as well, there's also the use of more advanced and formal vocabulary. So instead of tricky, we've used difficult. Instead of to spot, we've used identify. And instead of answer, we've used solution. So we're just taking our language up a notch. We're thinking a bit more carefully about the language we're using, and we're raising our game. We're selecting our words carefully rather than just using more simple words that come to mind at the start. So let's take a look. Amjan, okay. Good. Glad to hear we could help. You avoid pronouns where possible. Exactly. Yeah. Samit says, identify is formula. We'd actually say it's more formal, but very good point. You've got it. Okay. So let's have a look. Any other questions? No other questions here. Okay. So on we go. Round four. Okay, so we've got a little bit of a problem with round four. So I'm going to go and have a look if I can change the options here. So give me 1 second, everybody, while I try and fix this for you. Okay, excuse me. Okay. Sorry, I'm just getting the answer up here. A little bit of a technical error today. So let's just see if we can hang on a bit and get to the correct answer. No, we cannot. Okay. No, we cannot. So I'm going to go back to the original slide, which was this one here. So which of these is most appropriate for academic English? A, smoking causes cancer. B, smoking can cause cancer. Or C, smoking will cause cancer. So four, which one of these is most appropriate for academic English? Smoking causes cancer, smoking can cause cancer, or smoking will cause cancer. Which of these is the best choice? So more than one is grammatically correct, but what's the best choice, the most truthful, objective, clear choice? Omnia has put an interesting point here. It's a possibility, not a fact. So how does that affect your choice? Yusuf's going for can cause. Okay, and again, we're looking for the why. So the correct answer is important, but so is the why. Today it's much more important to look at the reason behind it. Okay, and I'm just going to pick up on this here. Okay, nope, his comment is gone. All right, so I'm going to tell you the answer. The answer is B, smoking can cause cancer. And I don't have a slide for you because we are facing some technical issues today. The correct choice is B, can cause. Because if you smoke one cigarette, does that give you cancer? You've smoked, does that give you cancer? Does everybody who smokes get cancer? No. So we want to hedge our language. We want to be careful with our language so that we're being as accurate as possible. Smoking can cause cancer. Smoking is one of the main causes of cancer. Smoking may result in cancer. So even though you might see smoking causes cancer in a newspaper or on a magazine, or even on the front of a cigarette packet, in the UK at least, we want to be accurate and say that smoking can cause cancer, but not necessarily always will. So let's look at another more subtle example. So playing video games causes teenagers to become more aggressive. Is this true? Playing video games causes teenagers to become more aggressive. So we need to think, is this always true or is it sometimes true? It sometimes or might be theorized to say playing video games could cause teenagers to become more violent. Playing video games may result in more teenage violence. So we want to hedge our language, be very careful with the words we are choosing. Now, here's a relevant example for many of you, okay? Hard work results in success. Now, often hard work will result in success. Often if you do hard work, you will get success, but is it always true? Not necessarily. So we want to hedge it. Hard work can result in success. Hard work may result in success. Okay, so let's have a look. So Wulan said, not really, it's just, it is just one factor, or it could be just one factor, it may be. So Dr. Kaushalaya says maybe, exactly that. Yes, so can cause. Okay, it is not always true, exactly that, yes. So now Kushik saying option B makes more sense. So when you think about it, it's more accurate, isn't it? It's more objective, it's more truthful, it's closer to the truth, which is what we always want to do in academic English. Okay, let's have a look. We got a nice sentence from Sarah. Hard work can result in success. And let's have a look. Doubt is necessary in scientific sentences. Not always, only doubt if we're not 100% certain. So we can use definite sentences when we know 100%. So heat melts ice. Okay, we know this because that's a scientific fact. Okay, so I can't see any obvious questions jumping up here. So we're going to move on to question number 5 with Jan. Hi, Jan. Oops, where are you, Jan? Hi.
Hi.
Hi again. How are you?
I'm fine, thank you.
Good. So you've kindly come back to give us the answers to this quiz. Could you remind us of your question, please?
Yes, my question was, the BBC was set up 100 years ago. But we said that set up is a phrasal verb and that sometimes in academic writing, we avoid phrasal verbs. So my question was, which of these sentences would be the best to substitute for set up? So the options were, is it A, the BBC was created 100 years ago, or B, the BBC was implemented 100 years ago, or C, the BBC was established 100 years ago?
Okay, and we've got lots of people who are quite confident about the answer. Drum roll, please.
And the answer, everybody, is C, established. So the BBC was established 100 years ago.
Okay, and could you tell us why exactly the answer is C?
Yes, so if we use the word create, then create is talking about something original, something totally new. But we can establish, when we establish something, it means, I think one of your audience said before, we stabilize it, we secure it. So you could create something, it's totally original. You could establish something, and it means to put it into the foundations of society. So when the BBC was established, it wasn't the first time that a broadcasting company had happened in the world, but it was the first time it was being secured in the UK. And then with implemented, to implement something means to carry something out. And ordinarily, we'd be talking about implementing policies or projects. So often, implementation of something might be more temporary than establishing something.
Okay, and Jan, I've got a question for you. So at the start of your question earlier, you said we don't generally use phrasal verbs in academic English.
Yeah.
And could you tell us why not, and what should we do instead?
Okay, so usually with phrasal verbs, often we use them in conversation, and often the words used in a phrasal verb can not represent what you're actually trying to say. So, for example, if I said to you, "Oh, Dylan, I am fed up today." Fed up obviously means sad or disappointed, but if you were analyzing the word, you might think it was something to do with how much I had eaten or how much I had been fed. So, with that reason, in order to make things clearer for everybody, we could use phrasal verbs if they were very clear. So, for example, I could say a source has pointed out that because that's easy for everyone to understand. We understand we're pointing, we understand we're signifying something. But if your phrasal verb has a lot of imagery around it that the reader mightn't understand because the meaning's different in a phrasal verb than usual, we should avoid it.
Okay, so it's best to be careful or selective with our choice of
It
phrase.
is best to be selective. And obviously, we're talking a lot today about formal tone. And because phrasal verbs are often used in informal speech, it's often better to avoid them where possible. So instead of saying fed up, I could say I am depressed. Instead of saying to put up with something in academic writing, it would be best if I use something like the word tolerate.
Okay, and not all of our audience will be students. Do you think that removing phrasal verbs can also help people write more formally for their job or in other formal situations?
Oh, I think writing without phrasal verbs is good for legal English or business English or communication in general. When you want a bit of gravitas, when you want to be taken as a professional or an expert, and rather than just a friend or acquaintance, get rid of the phrasal verbs.
Okay, cool. And Jan, we've got a question for the audience. Can we say the BBC was founded 100 years ago?
Yes, you could. Yes.
And why?
Well, because with established, it means it was set up for a long time, and founded has a very similar thing, but that shows that in the UK, this was the first time it was happening.
Okay, Jan, very, very clear explanation. Lots of
Thank
people
you.
saying thank you so much.
No worries. Nice to meet
Okay.
you, everybody.
Thanks for joining.
No
See you.
worries. Bye. See you,
Bye.
Dylan. Bye.
Bye. All right, guys, that was Jan. So if you enjoyed Jan, please hit that like button. Okay, Jan, thank you very much if you're still listening. And we've got in academic writing, could or should we use idioms in general? No, try to avoid them. Again, for the same reason we avoid phrasal verbs, we don't want that imagery. We want very, very clear, cold language almost, where it's just there's. We do not use idioms. We want to keep it as objective as possible. What accent does Jan have? Jan is from Liverpool. Okay. And Samet has just discovered this channel today. Welcome, welcome, welcome. If you enjoy, you can also find this on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter, as well as YouTube. And you can check out our website, bbclearningenglish.com. Okay. So I usually learn academic writing from a newspaper. Okay, so newspaper writing and academic writing are not exactly the same. So even the broadsheets, the more formal newspapers, will not use precisely the standard of academic English, although they are very good places to learn. If you want to get familiar with academic English, check out some scientific articles or journals. They're the best places, I'd say. Do non-fiction books mostly use academic sentences? It depends. There's so many non-fiction books that it depends. Often they will write quite academically, but they don't follow the strict rules of academic English. Okay, so a few questions about accent coming in now. Yes, so my accent is from South Wales and Janet is from Liverpool. So not actually too far apart, maybe 3 hours apart. I do live in Liverpool as well, but I have a Welsh accent. Okay, let's have a look. All right, so lots of good comments. We've got, yes, Womi, as a journalist, we have to make it concise and easy reading as much as possible. So yes, there's a different tone, a different register, a different style for newspapers and magazines and academic English because it's got a different audience. Yeah. Okie dokie. All right. So what are some online sources of academic English for you? I will put some links into the show later on. So at the end of the show, I'll put some links for you to follow. And that's the same for Kieran's got a similar question as does Astism. Apologies for butchering your name there. Okay. On we go. So what question was it? Question number six. And apologies for some technical issues today. We tried a new way of presenting the information and it hasn't quite worked. So C6. It was achievement. Which is best in an essay? Is it A, a humongous or huge achievement? B, a big deal achievement? C, a considerable achievement? Or D, a biggie achievement? Which of these is best in an essay? And I remember it was previously it was a huge achievement. So a huge, humongous, very similar. B, a big deal. C, a considerable. Or D, a biggie. What do you think? Lots and lots of C's coming in. A few A's. Okay. I did say huge. Yes, agreed. Today, we tried something new. It hasn't quite worked. So we'll probably go back to the old format next week. But yes, thanks for pointing out that it has slightly changed. Okay. Yes, the correct answer. It was a considerable achievement. Now, let's have a look at why. So huge or humongous, it's a bit simple or a bit childish or a bit informal. They sound a bit basic. It sounds like the word of a child rather than the professional academics that we want to portray ourselves as. So we avoid these simpler words like good and bad and big and small and tiny and nice and stuff and thing and kind of. These simple basic words we kind of avoid. These simple words we avoid. We want to make a better, more advanced choice. And we've got big deal and biggie, too informal. Big deal and biggie also is grammatically incorrect, so definitely not B-O-D. If you remember, the first time we saw it, fantastic was a choice. And we don't use fantastic or good or great or terrible because it shows our opinion. It shows that we think it's good. We think it's interesting or cool or awesome. But in academic English, we want to keep our opinions out of the matter. We want to portray those cool, hard, unemotional facts, the objective truth. So considerable is the best choice here. So Elin's never heard of humongous before. It's quite a childish word, really. It's quite a silly sounding word. It's a fun word to say, oh, it was humongous. It's quite a comedic word to describe something that was enormous. Okay, so these rules, these academic English rules are for any country, any English speaking country or English journal article these rules would apply. And Dr. Kausler says, yes, only A and C are grammatically correct choices. May I say it was a good achievement? Now, grammatically you can, but it shows your opinion. And we do, it shows that you think it was good, but we actually want to just, we want to get to the truth. It doesn't matter what we think, we want to get to an objective truth. So we avoid using good. And somebody else asked, substantial. Yes, it was a substantial achievement is also fine. Okay, on we go. Round 7. The quiz is a bit longer today, but I hope you're still with me. Good. Round 7. So again, the slides are not quite the same as before. The results won't be released until they've been verified. So is this good for an essay or bad for an essay? Or the question we asked before is, what isn't quite right with a sentence? So we're looking for, how can we improve this? What if we improve, how can we improve this essay? And Mahit is asking a question about number 6. Yes, considerable is definitely the best choice. Okay. But what is the, how can we improve this sentence here? If Jenny says a lot of contraptions, you're very close, but we're looking for a slightly different word, okay? And that is shortened forms like won't should be avoided. And the word, Evgeny, is contractions. Contractions. Yes, okay? So instead of the results won't be released until they've been verified, we should say the results will not be released until they have been verified. So the results will not be released until they have been verified. Okay. Any questions about that? So we don't use contractions, as a few of you pointed out. So instead of won't, will not. Instead of they have. Instead of it, we use it is. Instead of didn't, we use did not. Instead of couldn't, we use could not. So please avoid contractions where possible. All right, I'm going to go on. Round 8, our final question. Let me just take a look for any questions here. We've got an interesting question here. Is the speed you are teaching English to us the same as when you were talking to a native, or is it slower? So for me, I have 3 speeds. I have the speed I talk when I'm with my friends from South Wales with the same accent, who are familiar with my accent. And we tend to speak very, very quickly down where I am from. So I've got my, when I'm in South Wales, I speak a bit more like this and it's very, very fast. And then I speak a little bit slower when I'm outside of Wales. So I'm in Liverpool, so I speak quite slowly and clearly. And because they might not be familiar with my accent. So in London or Scotland or Ireland or Manchester, I will slow down a little bit. And then this speed here is a little bit slower again. It's quite, you know, it's not very, very slow, but it's a little bit slower than normal. Nice question. And the last one, because of course, academic and formal English is not just about writing, but it can be about speaking as well. So here are some ways to end a formal presentation. Which one is best? A, I'd like to sum up now. B, so, in conclusion. C, that's all, folks. And D, let me end up by saying. Which of these is the correct choice? And Mario's asked, must we avoid only on writing or on speaking as well? Must we avoid what? Sorry, Mario, I'm not sure what you mean exactly. Could you clarify, and I'll try and answer your question later. All right, lots and lots of you coming in. we got a few people saying, see, that's all, folks, which of course is from Looney Tunes. Porky Pig used to say, that's all, folks, at the end of that. So it's definitely not C. A is okay. It's fine. Okay, there's no problem. If you use it no problem at all. But the rules about, remember we mentioned about personal pronouns. In speaking, in spoken English or in formal presentations, when we are speaking, we are less strict about the personal pronouns rule, but we try to avoid them if we can. So I'd like to sum up. It's fine, but I think a better one is in conclusion. So academic writing and speaking has a lot of signposting language, and this tells the reader or listener what to expect next. They tell you what is coming and help you to follow the thread more clearly. So we use lots of stock phrases like this essay seeks to investigate, or the aim of this study is to, or the evidence highlights, and lots of phrases like in conclusion, to summarize, as has been illustrated above. So we use lots of these stock phrases to signpost our writing to make it very, very clear. Okay. Poof, a long session today, guys. Let's take a look here. So have a good weekend, says Amelia. Have a good weekend. Please, guys, if you have had a good time, if you've learned something new, hit that like button, please. Like, love, share. The more, the merrier. It really does help. It doesn't seem like a lot, but it really does help. Congratulations, Alfiero. Good job, Tangina. Hi, Tangina. We've spoken a lot on Facebook with the comments. 6 out of 8. Good job. And Yilin, in conclusion, you've learned it from your ESOL English lesson. Yeah, it's quite common. It's basic, but it does the trick. It's totally valid. It's a good choice. In summary, in summation, both great choices. So 3 out of 8 for here we go. They were quite hard. Yeah, it's a little bit different today, isn't it? Normally we look at idioms and phrasal verbs, and today we're looking at more specific language, the language of university. And if you have not studied it before, it can be quite tricky. But if you would like to write more formally for university or for your work or just in general, hopefully there's some valuable points there today. Lots of people saying thanks. So must we avoid contraction only in writing or in speaking as well? So all of the rules we looked at today apply to speaking as well, but less strictly. So we might try to avoid contractions, for example, but not every time. It's not a strict rule. No, it's not as strict with speaking. We could be a bit more relaxed and be a bit more natural because we want the audience to enjoy as well. Okay. And let's have a look. So folks is an informal word. Totally agree. Sum up now is like someone in a hurry. Agreed. And end up is like sum up. I agree. Very casual words that it seems a bit too relaxed and informal for a presentation in my mind. Whew. Okay then, guys. That's me done. That's an hour of talking. I am worn out. I am ready for the weekend. Have a lovely time. The next quiz, next Friday, 1:30 p.m. UK time, Facebook and YouTube. See you there. Bye.